Hi, it's Katrina. From famous sculptures found in long-lost caves to the key to unlocking the mystery of Egyptian hieroglyphics, here are 10 archaeological discoveries made by ordinary citizens. Number 10. Ringlemere Cup. Cliff Bradshaw was out exploring with his metal detector when he discovered a highly valuable artifact known as the Ringlemere Cup. The crumpled cup might not seem like much, but it dates back to the Bronze Age between 1700 to 1500 BC. The cup was hammered out of a single ingot of gold and beaten into its desired shape. It's only one of seven of this type that have been found, making it not just valuable, but rare. It's believed that these types of vessels were used as votive offerings and not necessarily from a burial mound. Unfortunately, at some point in time, it had been badly crushed by a plow, but it is considered one of the oldest treasures ever found in Britain and was purchased by the British Museum through donations for $520,000. It is in the top 10 list of archaeological treasures found in Britain. Number 9. Lascaux Cave Paintings. 18-year-old Marcel Ravidat was walking with his dog Robot when Robot suddenly fell into a hole somewhere around Montignac, France on September 12, 1940. Marcel rescued his dog and decided to go back to explore, bringing three friends along with him. They discovered the entrance to what would become one of the most famous and incredible discoveries of our time. The friends slipped inside the opening and found a larger cave, and inside was full of incredibly large, detailed drawings of animals and symbols dating back 15,000 to 17,000 years ago, some of the oldest artworks in human history. While they may not be the oldest or the largest, they are definitely iconic. They thought they might be onto something big, so the teens alerted their teacher, who in turn contacted specialists to come and explore the cavern. There are somewhere around 600 paintings on the walls of this cave in total, as well as around 1,500 engravings. The pictures depict horses, red deer, stags, bovines, felines, and what appear to be mythical creatures. There is a lot of detail showing the illusion of depth and motion. These are now thought to be some of the most excellent examples of Upper Paleolithic period artworks. Due to the sheer amount of art inside of the caves, experts think that it might have been some kind of ritualistic meeting area. There are holes in the wall, demonstrating that prehistoric people first built a type of scaffold to be able to reach and paint higher on the walls. Word got out and people flocked to the site to see the mysterious cave. While it was open to the public in 1948, it had to be closed down in 1963 due to the large amounts of carbon dioxide from people breathing that was damaging the paintings. They are also under threat from a mysterious fungus that has started to spread. Visitors can visit an exact replica at the site called Lascaux 2 to learn more and appreciate the prehistoric masterpiece without damaging the original, which is a protected UNESCO World Heritage Site. Number 8. Jacobean Jewelry. In 1912, some workers were doing repairs on the Wakefield House, which is located in Cheapside, London. Little did everyone know that a treasure had been lying there undisturbed for around 300 years. The property had been around since the 17th century and was in need of some repair. While working in the cellar breaking up the floor, construction workers hit something and noticed something shiny. They had hit an old wooden chest full of jewelry. And it wasn't a tiny chest either. It had almost 500 pieces of jewelry from the 16th and 17th centuries, including an agate cameo of Elizabeth I, a gold watch set in a massive emerald from Colombia, sapphires, diamonds, rubies, pearls, opals, turquoise, along with other gems. This discovery is now known as the Cheapside Hoard, after where it was found. But who left all of this treasure behind in the first place, and why did they never come back for it? Because Wakefield House was on so-called Goldsmith's Row, experts think that this hoard belonged to a goldsmith who was keeping his stash safe during the English Civil War. The workers are rumored to have filled their pockets and hats with jewels and sold them to a pawn shop owner, who was actually the London Museum's head of acquisitions. They recovered the stolen artifacts, and they now belong to the Museum of London. These workers clearly did not have the best of intentions, but all's well that ends well, as they say. The Museum of London calls this discovery a time capsule and says that it continues to be the most important source of our knowledge of Elizabethan and early Stuart jewelry in England because so little jewelry of this date has survived. And it also provides unparalleled information on the international gem trade and London's role in acquiring and trading in jewelry from all over the world. Number 7. Medieval Tomb. On an unassuming farm in Stolp, a municipality in northeastern Germany, a badger had made an underground den on the property. Two sculptors who lived on the farm, who also happened to be amateur archaeologists, decided to exhibit some of their work near the badger's area. When they went to explore, they spotted a pelvic bone just lying there outside of the den. They weren't too shocked, since years before, a cemetery had been found on the other side of the road. The badger was long gone, so they decided to stick a camera in the underground den to see what else the badger may have found. Turns out there was jewelry and more bones, so they alerted the authorities. The badger had found just one piece of what would turn out to be 8 graves from the first half of the 12th century at the site, including 2 containing Slavic chieftains and another a warrior. Hendrik Ring, one of the sculptors, said this doesn't make the badger an archaeologist, but he's the one who discovered it. Archaeologists had never found graves like this in the area before, so they were very excited about the find. They also discovered a 3-foot-long sword, a belt with 2 attached snake heads, and a coin inside a skeleton's mouth. The sculptors received an award for services to archaeology and are considering the badger an honorary member of the team. Number 6. Venus de Milo. The Venus de Milo is one of the most famous statues in the entire world, and it was discovered by a humble farmer preparing a field on the island of Melos. However, while he was plowing, he discovered a mysterious cave, and he decided to take a look. This would change art history forever. When he peeked inside, he found one half of the sculpture of Aphrodite, the Greek goddess associated with love and pleasure. But after that, things got a little confusing. One story says that this farmer, Georgios Kentrotas, tried to hide the sculpture inside of his own barn. Maybe he knew how valuable it would be and just wanted to keep all of the gold and glory for himself. But Turkish officials eventually caught wind of Kentrotas' discovery and took it from the barn, after which they delivered it to Louis XVIII, the King of France at the time. Louis XVIII decided to put the statue inside of the Louvre. In fact, if you're interested, that's where you can go see it today. Others say that Kentrotas was hanging out with Oliver Vautier, a French official, at the time of the discovery, and that Vautier got Kentrotas to seek out the other half of the statue. He found it, and the French wanted it for themselves, but Kentrotas decided to just sell it to someone else in Romania. Then a bidding war ensued, and a group of people purchased the statue as a gift for Louis XVIII. We may never know which story is exactly right, but Kentrotas' discovery will be remembered by the world for generations. Number 5. The Rosetta Stone. One of the most important discoveries ever found in history is the Rosetta Stone. Until it was discovered, no one knew how to interpret the hieroglyphics found everywhere in Egypt. It has proved crucial to deciphering Egyptian hieroglyphs and has even made it possible to understand other writings that have been found. The stone is inscribed with the same phrases in Greek, which was also spoken by the Egyptians toward the end of the empire, as well as Egyptian Demotic, the language of the people, and hieroglyphics, mostly used by priests and royalty. The most important find ever in Egyptology was made purely by accident. It was found by Pierre Bouchard, a French captain who was overseeing the restoration of a fort near the town of Rosetta in 1799, during the Napoleonic Wars. During these works, his men found a 3-foot-9-inch block of rock that was inscribed with 3 different distinct types of writing. He realized that this was something truly significant, but the stone soon fell into the hands of the British following the French surrender of Egypt in 1801. The stone is a broken part of a bigger stone slab with a decree that proclaimed the power of King Ptolemy V and in effect initiated his cult, written in 3 different scripts. Written after the conquest of Alexander the Great, Egyptian society at this point was heavily influenced by Greco-Macedonian culture. Hieroglyphics fell out of use around the 4th century AD, and slowly people forgot how to read and write them. The British Museum says that it was Thomas Young, an English physicist, who was the first to show that some of the hieroglyphs on the Rosetta Stone wrote the sounds of a royal name, that of Ptolemy. Then, scholar Jean-François Champollion realized that hieroglyphs recorded the sound of the Egyptian language. From there, the door into the past was opened, and suddenly, thanks to the discovery of French soldiers, we are now able to understand much about the ancient Egyptians. The Rosetta Stone has been on display at the British Museum since 1802. Everyone who encountered it immediately appreciated its value from the very beginning. Number 4. 1.5 millionth item from the Portable Antiquities Scheme. For the past couple of decades, the British Museum has been running a program known as the Portable Antiquities Scheme, whose job is to record those archaeological discoveries made by everyday citizens. But recently, they passed the 1.5 million mark. That's right, they've now recorded over 1.5 million archaeological objects found by ordinary people. So what item pushed the Portable Antiquities Scheme over the 1.5 million mark? As it turns out, a citizen in Shropshire, England, found a seal that belonged to Pope Innocent IV, who was the leader of the Catholic Church from 1243 to 1254. This lead seal, known as a papal bulla, would have been used to make certain papal documents official. You couldn't be sure if your indulgences or official church declarations were official if you didn't have the papal stamp. But although this discovery marked an important milestone for the Portable Antiquities Scheme, it was certainly not the most important discovery. Other discoveries featured within the scheme include the Staffordshire Hoard, a bunch of Anglo-Saxon war gear which helped us understand their culture with greater clarity, and the Ringlemere Cup that I told you about earlier. Number 3. The Lyceum. In ancient Greece, when it came to higher education, there were two institutions in town: the Academy, founded by Plato, and the Lyceum, founded by Plato's student Aristotle in 335 BC. These two places are considered the beginning of the modern university, where discussions and lectures were open to the public. Aristotle lived from 384 to 322 BC and studied under Plato and tutored Alexander the Great. Over the years, the school was eventually lost to time. Archaeologists and historians worked for many years to try and uncover the remains of the ancient place of learning, but to no avail for 150 years. But that didn't mean that it wasn't still out there. And in fact, in spite of archaeologists' efforts, its eventual discovery occurred completely by accident. When a bunch of workers were constructing a parking lot for Athens' projected Museum of Modern Art, they discovered a large plaza and a wrestling arena. Just the kinds of things you would have seen at the Lyceum at the time. Experts arrived at the scene and verified that this was indeed the location of Aristotle's Lyceum. Greece's Minister of Culture, Evangelos Venizelos, said, "There is no doubt whatsoever that this is the school where Aristotle taught. We have decided that the excavations to unearth the remains will continue, and that the site will coexist in harmony next to the Museum of Modern Art, so that the two can be visited simultaneously by Greeks and tourists." Number 2. Grabal Man. In 1952, laborers discovered the Grabal Man, an incredibly well-known set of mummified remains, while they were working at a peat bog. That's actually one of the reasons that the Grabal Man is so well-preserved. In random areas around Denmark and other parts of Europe, these peat bogs are known for having a remarkably low concentration of oxygen, as well as a high acidity content. That means that whatever organic material sits there really stays there, preserved for hundreds of years. It's also what makes this mummy's hair red rather than his natural color. Scientists have dated the Grabal Man to some point in the 3rd century BC, which was smack dab in the middle of the Iron Age. But it looks like the Grabal Man didn't have a pleasant end. By inspecting his body, researchers are pretty sure that this mummy died by pointedly unnatural causes. They've speculated that he probably had his throat slit for some kind of ceremonial sacrifice. There have actually been a bunch of mummies discovered in peat bogs like this one. Because of this phenomenon, archaeologists have taken to referring to these kinds of mummies as bog people. Many people use peat as a fuel source, so when they go to get it, they might find a mummy or two. And sometimes it's hard to know how old they are. Pretty creepy, right? Number 1. Staffordshire Hoard. In 2009, Terry Herbert was out exploring a field outside of Hammerwich, Staffordshire, with his metal detector, when he made the discovery worth several lifetimes. When his metal detector went off to tell him he'd found something, he was expecting a coin or maybe someone's lost pocket watch. What he found instead was the largest hoard of Anglo-Saxon treasure ever found in the United Kingdom. The Staffordshire Hoard, as the artifacts came to be called, included over 3,500 pieces of high-quality gold and silver metalwork created by the Anglo-Saxon residents of the medieval kingdom of Mercia. Almost everything in the hoard is related to war and warfare, including weaponry, ornaments from sword pommels, and crosses that were meant to give the bearer protection in battle. There are artifacts representing both Christian and pagan symbolism, but experts aren't sure why it was buried where it was. Perhaps it was meant to be retrieved later, or perhaps it was meant to be some type of ritual. The sword pommels appear to have been deliberately removed from the swords themselves and added to the hoard. Another famous artifact is a helmet. Experts think it was destroyed before it was buried. there is an entire range of objects that give extraordinary insight into Saxon craftsmanship and culture. Thanks for watching! What do you think is the most amazing archaeological discovery made by regular people? Which one would you like to have found? Let me know in the comments below. Remember to subscribe and give this video a thumbs up for more videos like these. See you soon! Bye!